Good morning. Welcome to Grace Center. We are glad you are here this morning. We are here because of Jesus. If you would please stand. We're just going to praise and worship our God. Hey, I just wanted to say I've been meditating on something. My name is Tony Wakefield, by the way. I'm one of the pastors on staff here. Good morning. I've been thinking and meditating on Psalm 16, verse 3. And it says, and I take this for myself, and I've been meditating on it, not just for myself, but for all of us. And it says, "You are my noble ones, in whom is all my delight. You are my noble ones, in whom is all my delight." So I just pray this morning as we enter into God's presence that He pours out a grace and a mercy that we can come into agreement with what He says about us. And that He would come in the very places where we're stuck, where our own self-talk and self-belief doesn't line up with the fact that we are His noble ones, in whom is all His delight. So, Father, we receive Your delight this morning. We receive what You speak over us. And Father, we reflect that delight and we say, Father, we are delighted in You. Come and fill our worship this morning, Father, as we just pour ourselves out on You. Thank You for being here with us. In Jesus' name.
starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you. Oh, it's when you walk into the room, everything changes, the darkness starts to tremble. Stop. We can't live without I've tasted and I've seen. Come on. just a moment in your presence, yeah. Just a moment in your presence changes everything, Jesus, yeah. Would you come even more? Come even more. God, let our hearts be open to you. Come do what only you can do. Do what
Attention to the clock. I pay attention to the presence. And whatever the present, whatever he's doing, that's what we do. That's what we flow into. And so even though the song set is ended, we've not ended yet. We're just still here. I just really felt like that there was something on just the voices singing. And just wonder if we could do that again a couple of times. And you know, the thing that I want to, we're so good in the American church with, you know, understanding a song and it's sung three times here or two times here, then it ends here. And I was just noticing how we did the two full on and then it kind of, well, this is the part where it ends. It's like, no. No, that's the part where the recording ended. That's not the part where the worship ends. And so I just feel like there's an opening right now, if we'll step into it, where, Lord, we give you space. We give you space. We give you space. We give you space. Holy Spirit, we give you space. We give you space. We give you space. We just give you space. We clear our schedule. We clear this. We give you space. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory. Amen. 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 Yours is the kingdom. Angels are worshiping right now. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever and ever. You alone are worthy, Lord. You alone are worthy. You alone are worthy. All authority, all honor, all power, all glory belong to you. Amen and amen and amen. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever and ever. We worship, we worship, we worship, we worship you, we worship you, we bless you. Voices. I was just telling them, guys, there's something on just the voices. Can we sing that? Just starting out quiet.
Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever. Amen. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power.
Thank you.
We say that there's no one like you. There's no one like you. There's no one like you in your mercy. There's no one like you, Jesus, in your humility. There's no one like you. Focus our attention, Lord, on you. We gaze upon you, Lord. Far be it from us, Lord, to be a thankless people. Far be it from us. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you for our breath. We thank you. We're breathing. All of our life is in you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Could you just open your mouth? Would you just begin to thank him? We thank you. We thank you. 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 Continue to thank him. I just feel this. Hold, Lord, if there's a deficit in our thankfulness tank, Lord, I ask, Lord, would you forgive us, Lord? We thank you. Far be it from us to be a thankless people. Far be it from me to be a thankless person. We thank you. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy of all thankfulness, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We stand in your presence, Lord, in thanksgiving. We thank you, Lord. We're full of thanksgiving. We're full of thanksgiving, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. For some of us, that muscle's really weak. That's what we're doing right now. We're exercising our thankful muscle. For some of us, it's really weak. Just keep pushing. Say thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It's never enough. It would never be enough. We could stand here for a billion years saying thank you. It would never be enough. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. You have poured out upon us, Lord. You have poured out. You chose us. We didn't choose you. Lord, you initiated. You still initiate. We love you, Abba. Forgive us, Lord, for focusing on all the places that we think you haven't come through. Forgive us. And forgetting all the places that you have. Far be it from us, Lord. Far be it from us. Increase our awareness of you, Lord. Increase our awareness of you, Lord. We ask that the eyes of our heart would be enlightened, would be opened even more, even more, even more, even more. worship, and I was remembered this thing that happened. Our kids were probably 6 and maybe 4. Joel was 4. Maybe 3 and a half. I can't remember. I remember that. Heard Bethany and Joel in the car. They were talking back and forth, and I wasn't paying attention to their conversation. And then there was this divine silence, this divine break, if you would. And I heard Joel say one of the most profound things I've ever heard. I think they were having a theological argument. You'll see why. He said, "You can't get to God. God has to come to you." So, whoa. Some of you are trying to get to God, and yet there's this thing where He's wanting to come to you. Jesus said, "I will not leave you as an orphan. I'll come to you. I'll come to you." And so I feel like there are people here right now that sounds totally insane to you. It's like, what do you mean? I've been trying to get to God. It's like, stop. Allow Him to come to you. It says in John, "For as many as received Him, to them He gave the right to become sons and daughters." As many as received, not recognized, they received. I feel like right now He is right, standing right in front of you. Just receive. Just say, "I receive. I receive you. We receive you, Jesus. We receive you in all of your beauty, and all of your splendor, and all of your holiness. We receive you. Abba, Father, we receive you. Holy Spirit, we receive you. We receive you. We receive you. We declare your nearness is our good. Your nearness, Lord, is my good." I wonder if we could, could you guys turn up the house lights? I want to do something. it feels like the right thing to do right now. So we're not going to transition. I want you to stay right in this mindset, this spirit set, because what we're about to do next is just as holy as what we've been doing. Okay? We are going to bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord. There's something holy. There's something holy right now that's happening. And if we're not careful, we can, because of our transitional way of thinking, we can think, okay, now we're doing something different. Oh, no. It's just as holy as anything that we've done so far is to give our tithes and our offerings before the Lord. And so what I'm going to ask us to do, normally we do a declaration. I'm going to ask, I'm concerned that if we did the declaration, it would take us out of this place that we're in right now. And we, you know what? We're all big boys and big girls. We can take an offering without the declarations. Right? But there's something there's an opening right now to where I feel like us giving before the Lord, it's like, how do we respond? It's almost like a response to worship, if you would. Father, Lord, this is our heart's response to you. This is our response to you. Lord, everything that we have is yours. Everything that we have is yours, Lord. This is just a token of going of appreciation. Said, we thank you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you, Lord, for the places we're going to see multiple times where the Lord, by his mercy and his grace, he protected, he shielded, he moved, he caused things not to break down when they should have broken down. He caused all, and so, Lord, right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, this is my feeble attempt to say thank you. I appreciate you. I see you. Thank you so much, Lord. So, Father, I pray, Lord, for everyone, Lord, in the sound of my voice. Maybe you're watching online and you don't go to this church, and that give something. Something needs to be given. There's an opening right now. It's just part of our, it's not even duty. It's not, don't even pull that word. Don't even think that word. This is a love offering. This is something that's done out of love. We so love you, Lord. We so appreciate you. We so honor you. We thank you, Lord. So if the ushers, if you guys could begin to, I'm going to pass the bags, Lord, in this canopy of holiness, Lord, that we're standing in right now, this canopy of your mercy, this canopy of Lord, the fact that we are here and you are here, that was unthinkable before Jesus came. That was totally unthinkable. Jesus, you have reconciled us. You've brought us into the holy, most holy place. You are in the most holy place right now, people. You are standing, you're seated in the most holy place in the universe by the blood of Jesus. Father, Lord, would you forgive us where the spirit of poverty comes in and tries to grab hold of us and say, if I give this away, what's going to happen to me? Lord, forgive us, Lord. Forgive us. We're still growing out of that orphan thing. Thank you, Lord. Remind us, Lord, of your word where it says you are faithful even when we are faithless. There's some folks standing in the back. If you have an open seat, could you maybe just raise your hand and people can come and sit there, sit beside you. obviously this is not the there's something special that's happening, let's say it like that. I did this at first service, wanted to make you guys aware. So you might not be aware of what's going on today. I think it's already happened in Paris, France. I just want to read you a couple of things. Sorry, told Fred, no, keep playing. Now I'm saying, no, maybe stop. Maybe so. It's on Sunday, January the 15th, which is today, more than 70 nations and organizations will gather in Paris. Their goal is to, quote, facilitate the establishment of a Palestinian state. Or in other words, to divide the land of Israel. And they give various reasons as to why this is happening. The ambassadors are, one of the reasons is they are putting pressure on Israel to conform and to give up part of their land, which maybe you don't know this, but that's a big no-no. And there's actually pressure to get this thing done, especially before our next president takes office, because of what he has said about Israel. And this is not about the president, but this is about Israel right now. And regardless of the timeline of what's happened, I know they're like, 7 hours ahead of us or 8 hours ahead of us, but I want us to be aware of this and to be praying as a church. It says in Scripture that those who bless Israel, God will bless. And we are a church that actually blesses Israel. And I'm just going to read this one little piece and then we'll transition. But the document that there was something that happened on January the 6th, and I believe that was the date, somebody helped me, that America decided not to vote. Is it December 23rd? Okay. Anyway, America, by choosing not to vote, actually voted. So we're asking that the Lord would actually have mercy, and I'm going to read you a scripture here in a minute. But I just want to let you I'm going to outline, here are the goals and the strategies of this conference. Number one, to divide the land of Israel into two states, Israel and Palestine, as the only way to achieve peace. Condemning all Jewish construction and settlement activity, including in the Jewish quarter of Jerusalem's Old City, based on recent UN Security Resolution 2334. Jewish building of homes across the Green Line is now equated as on par with terrorist violence. Israelis are called upon to disavow their own official government if it rejects the division of the land of Israel. And the 70 nations do not accept the results of the Israel Six-Day War back in June of 1967. And they insist that Israel withdraw from all territory liberated by the IDF. So here's what I want us to do. I want us to pray. But let me read something from the book of Joel. Chapter 3, verse 1 says, "For behold, in those days and at that time, when I restore the fortunes of Judah and Jerusalem, I will gather all the nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat. Then I will enter into judgment with them there on behalf of my people and my inheritance, Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations, and they have divided up my land." So Israel is not actually just Israel's land, it's actually his land. And so I'm not going to get into an end times theological debate or eschatology teaching or anything. I'm just saying, I want to pay really close attention to those that there's something about, if you've never been to Israel, you should go, because I didn't really get it till I went there. And I went, oh, there's something about this actually, this piece of terra right here. Why? This is bizarre that you would say that this is yours. They're saying that it's theirs. And so anyway, there's something about the people. There's something about this land. And so anyway, I want us, if we could, let's just stand together. And I want us to pray. And I want us to pray out loud. And I want us to pray that God would speak to the leaders of the nations and reveal his heart to them. I want us to pray that the Lord would protect his Jewish people from evil plans, evil nations, and also want to pray for the strengthening and revelation of the Jewish people. And so can we just take just a minute and begin to do that? I'll lead us, but yeah. So Father, Lord, we come before you in the name of Jesus. And just open your mouth. Lord, we are asking, Lord, we come before you, Lord, in reverence and holiness. Lord, we come before you, Lord, through the blood of Jesus. And Lord, we are coming before you, Lord, asking for mercy. Again, Lord, would you give us mercy, Lord? We ask, Lord, that you would, by your peace, Lord, that you would give peace, Lord, and wisdom to the rulers of these nations, Lord. I ask, Lord, that for those that don't have a peace about this, Lord, I'm asking, Lord, that they would even be governed by peace, even though they can't specifically articulate, this is why I don't feel like this is a good idea, but I just don't have a peace. Lord, we ask, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we declare, we stand here, we bless Israel. We bless that land. We bless those people, Lord. We ask, Lord, for the salvation, Lord, of the Jewish people, Lord. We ask, Lord, for a lifting of the veil, Lord. We ask, Lord, for the spirit of wisdom and revelation to come, Lord. We ask, Lord, that all everything would bring you glory, Lord, in this. And Lord, we confess, Lord, we confess the sins of those that are, Lord, we just help, Lord. We're repenting in the name of Jesus. We repent, Lord. Forgive us, Lord. But we ask, Lord, for mercy, revelation, for wisdom, Lord. And the leaders of these countries, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would protect these countries, Lord, even in their ignorance, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you remember that we are but flesh, and as a father has compassion on his children, so you have compassion on those that fear you, Lord. But, Lord, we're asking, Lord, that your kingdom come, your will be done, Lord, in the land of Israel and what's happening right now, Lord, as we are witnessing historical days in our midst, with our very eyes, Lord. We are asking again in the name of Jesus that by your wisdom and by your mercy, Lord, we just declare mercy triumphs, Lord, over judgment. Your mercy, Lord, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, before you get seated, would you turn to the person beside you and just say, hey, good morning, my name is... All right. Guys, I know we did things out of order. Is there a way to queue up the video announcements? We got a lot of stuff to cover and a lot of information. And so if you would, just direct your attention to the screens.
Center, we're so excited to have you here today. If you're a first-time visitor and you have any questions, please find someone with a Grace Center badge and we'd be happy to help you. Now, time for your announcements.
Your 2016 giving statement is now available. In order to keep costs down, we are not mailing paper statements except as requested. To access and print your statement, log into MyGC. It's quick and easy, and you can find detailed instructions in the bulletin and the eLife. You and your sweetheart are cordially invited to Keep It Real Youth's second annual Valentine's Gala, an evening of dinner and entertainment on Saturday, February 11th. It will be a night to remember with live music, a silent auction, and more. Proceeds will help our students to attend our spring retreat in April and our mission trip to We Will Go in Jackson, Mississippi in June. Tickets include free childcare, and you can get yours now at gracecenter.us. In-house Encounter Weekend is February 2nd through 4th. This life-changing weekend is devoted to learning and applying practical tools that help us walk in healing and freedom in our everyday lives. Learn more and register at gracecenter.us. Our new members class is beginning on January 29th. In this class that meets for 3 Sunday mornings from 9 to 10 a.m., you will learn about Grace Center's core values and more. Register at gracecenter.us. Our Wednesday night classes kicked off last Wednesday. There's still time to join in the Journey of Worship class with Ray Hughes, where we are walking through an exploration of music and creativity in worship, and prophetic training, where we are learning the foundations of prophetic ministry and how to share God's heart with others. Register at gracecenter.us. Next Sunday morning, Christine Stroop is doing a free vocal workshop for Keep It Real Youth in the Firehouse. After church, there will also be a mandatory meeting for any student involved or interested in being involved in worship at Keep It Real Youth and their parents. Find out more on the youth page at gracecenter.us. Don't forget, senior high students are meeting after church today in the Firehouse. See you there. Our monthly men's meeting is tonight. Men are invited to join us from 5 to 8 p.m. as we build authentic connections and navigate the triumphs and disappointments of life together. There will be a suggested donation of $5 collected at the door to go towards dinner. It's not too late to RSVP at gracecenter.us. There are so many exciting things happening at Grace Center. Check your bulletin in the events page at gracecenter.us to learn about our upcoming events and to register. You can also sign up for our weekly email newsletter on the homepage at gracecenter.us. Have a great week, everybody.
All right, men's group tonight. Woohoo! Yeah. Well, okay, so Dann Farrelly is here this morning from Bethel. And it's probably a good chance a lot of you have never heard him. Great teaching and really funny and witty and everything that we love about Bethel. Funny, witty, brilliant teaching. I think, and anointed, yeah. Sure, throw that one in, yeah. And so anyway, he's going to come up here. He's here. He's been coming for the past, we'll say, 5 years. 5 years. Oh, wow. And speaking at the school, so he'll fly in like this afternoon. You guys would never see him come in and then do the teaching and then leave. And then so many people were being impacted by, some of our students were being impacted by his teaching that we thought, oh, what if we kind of backed it up a day and brought him in Saturday night and had him speak to Grace Center? It's like, oh, that's awesome. So Dann Farrelly's here. Can we welcome Dann Farrelly?
Hey, thanks. Thank you. You honor me. Wow. I didn't think I was preaching this morning. The Holy Spirit hit. We're just languishing in His presence. I'm like, I lay it down, God, and I'm good. Probably just going to... And then, whoop, then we... I'm preaching. But I do love that when a meeting catches fire like that, and, you know, when the people of God come hungry, those sorts of things, I think, happen more often. Just in our staff meeting, it was... It's just one of those interesting God moments when Ben Fitzgerald from Awakening Europe is there. He gives a report of how many are getting saved in Europe dramatically. And he gets done testifying, and then people are just quiet. Nobody has a comment. Nobody has another testimony yet. But you can just tell, like, a grateful spirit has entered the room. A thankful spirit has entered the room. And in staff meeting, they were just began to just declare, the, you know, just praises, just quietly coming up from the 20 of us in there. The tears start rolling, and then the quiet gives way to the fervent prayer for the continued inbreaking of God in these environments, and just amazing. So we get it from that, and then Benji, I think his last name is Roll from Exodus Cry. He happens to be in our staff meeting as well, and he's out of Kansas City and IHOP, and powerfully advocating on behalf of those caught up in sex trafficking and in all of the degradation and difficulty of that. And so he's there giving us a report about what still needs to be done. The sacred moment of we're seeing all these souls saved and salvation, yet one of our saints who's engaged in the culture says, hey, there's more to do. There's more breakthrough. There's more freedom coming to the nations and the people. And we're doing the most important work on the planet. Yeah. The Church of Jesus Christ is doing the most important work on the planet. And I know when I say that, I hope that you either have an attitude or you believe it or something. I hope that impacts you, that we are doing the most important work on the planet. And it begs the question, what is the most important work on the planet? It's a little bit of what I'm going to be talking to you about. And right in that staff meeting, we had kind of both. We had this expression that people are coming to salvation and discipleship all throughout Europe. And yet some are still in bondage. And the Lord has declared it the year of the Lord's favor. He has every year, by the way, is the year of the Lord's favor when he sets captives free, that people are still in captivity. And so, and I think as believers, we do this sacred, important work, this work of discipleship and this work of impacting society and bringing transformation to society. So the in thinking about that, I think a lot of us are motivated by different things, and some of us are motivated by the sacredness of the assignment, by the greatness of the assignment. Some of us are like, I want a high calling. I want the Lord to give me an assignment kind of that matters, that's worth something, and that motivates us, and that sense of duty, that sense of significance is incredibly powerful. Others of us, we're motivated by adventure, you know, we're just like, I want to just be on this adventure with the Lord, and who knows what's coming next and what I'm going to be led into. But when I'm walking with Father, when I'm saying what Jesus is saying, when I'm trying to follow the Spirit, I'm like, I'm on an adventure. Neither of those motivate me. But I know there's you, some of you in this room, if we had you raise your hands, you'd be like, no, I totally, man, that the sacredness of the assignment, those that have served in the military, you have an understanding of that more than even than I do the rest of us, that the sacred call of that you're involved in. So a lot of us, though, are like, I just want to have a pretty good life and have safe kids, and have my kids be safe and not make God, you know, look bad. You know, it's at some level, we're like, it's what I... A little bit of our steady Eddies of us. We're like, I'm just gonna, you know, I don't have to drive a great car. Like, I just gonna, you know, live the kingdom as best I can, and just, you know, get through life. And I realize that as I'm preaching and I'm talking to you, even the generation, what I'm gonna be speaking to you about a little bit, for some of us will be like those. Like, I'm 51. For some of us will be like, yeah, I get that. Some of you that are younger, a little bit, be like, what? You guys used to think that way? Or you still think that way? I'm aware there's going to be some dissonance as we're, you know, some of the, as I'm talking with you. Like, wow, you guys are really backward. I'm like, yeah, okay. So where I'm going to end up, I just want to foreshadow, you know, at the beginning, I want to start where I'm going to end up. And the Lord has just been speaking to me a ton about, out of this passage in John chapter 15, about abiding in him. And I'm going to read to you, I think, out of my phone Bible instead of my natural Bible because it's easier to read from up here. Let's see. Yep. So, chapter 15, I think that's verse 4. Abide in me and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you bear fruit unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he is that who bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Pretty profound, you know, invitation. That he says, hey, all the works you're going to do, They actually amount to nothing unless they flow from this abiding friendship and relationship that we have. And it there's probably some, again, that word dissonance, that those two notes that don't go together. If you're like me, you can't, I read Jesus and I totally believe Jesus, let's be clear. But I go, seems like I can do a lot of stuff without you, Jesus. I mean, at some level, like I can do some ministry pretty good. You know, I've got enough emotional capacity to listen to somebody like, yes, that sounds like a personal problem. But we have this sense where we can, you know, we can get some breakthrough and do some stuff, you know, without abiding in Jesus. But he's pretty clearly said all the meaningful stuff, the real fruit that you do will come from this abiding relationship that you and I have with him. And at the end, I want to kind of give you a couple of questions to think through. For you just to sort out, like, hey, am I really living an abiding sort of connection with Jesus? There's more in this passage that we'll see if we have time to get into. Bearing much fruit. Actually, we'll get into it now. So the Lord says, I so left my notes this morning from the previous message that now I'm like, I don't even know what's on those. Or no, they're still good, but I still love my notes. I'm a teacher guy. So I'm like, I worked hard on those. So the I had the organization all, So in this passage, if we kind of look through it a little bit, we do have this invitation to a powerful relationship. And I do find sometimes that we read it in the same passage, there's that part about whoever doesn't bear any fruit will be, will be cut off, and the branches will be gathered up and burned in the fire. You remember that part? That kind of happy part? Yeah, so that I do find sometimes that with the evangelical church, a lot of times we skip all the goodies and we find the problem, like, am I abiding enough? Am I bearing enough fruit? Like, just by the way, he says, it's not enough fruit, it's whoever bears no fruit. That's Jesus' issue. So I'm like, there's nobody in this room not bearing no fruit. And interestingly enough, he also said that you're already clean. It's the same word, you're already pruned because I've spoken to you. So let's not freak out about that. Like you going through looking at your life every day, like, did I bear fruit? Am I in the vine? Am I out? Am I in the vine? It'll make you crazy. It will make you crazy. If you've put your faith in Jesus, you've been adopted as his very own. And this invitation to abide is absolutely yours. You are, you know, he is your Abba Father, your heavenly daddy. And, living in this crazy thing that comes from the flesh and from the demonic realm of like, am I in? Am I out? Am I in? Am I out? That's just, there's no health there. Faith, put your faith in the goodness of God. Yet you got saved by faith and you stay saved by faith. So, bearing much fruit. In this particular passage as well, there's this incredible invitation. Like, so we focus on the scary part, but there's beautiful, there's so much beauty in this passage as we continue to read. Let me go on here, let's see. Abide in me as I abide in you. So it's like live in me as I'm living in you. As if you're, the NIV says remain in me. I think that's a bad translation because it feels like, are you going to stay? Like, well, you know, I'm going to come along and if you happen to be out of the vine at that time, then you get burned up. You know, it's like, I didn't remain. So this, it's like, well, let's see if you last. Like, I know you gave, let's see if you make it to the end. That's not the force of it. That word remain has kind of that connotation that feels like that. But abide is much better when you look at how the Greek word is actually used in John. So abide in me. Verse 5, I'm the vine, you're the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he is that who bears much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And then he talks about if anyone doesn't abide, it's like a branch thrown away and withers, thrown into fire. That's the scary part I just spoke about. Now, verse 7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. And next verse, by this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and prove or demonstrate to be my disciples. And as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. You notice we center in on the negative, like, am I in the vine or not? And he's like, it's actually full of goodies. It's full of goodies. It's full of, like, we get this invitation, like, here's the king of the universe. Like, here's how this is going to roll between you and I. We're going to be buds. We're going to abide. We're going to live in the same house. Man, we're going to be family. We're going to be family. And by the way, I'm going to answer your prayer, and then the things that you wish, yeah, I'm gonna bring those to pass. So answered prayer. And he goes on and says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. That's a lot of love. Jesus is like, how should I compare? What should I compare my love to? How about Father's love for me? Yeah, that's a good comparison about how I love you. So he says, abide in my love. Live in the house of my love. And he goes, if you keep my commandments, here you go. Yeah, I knew there was a catch. As an obligation, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. The things I've spoken to you, I've spoken these things that your joy, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. Again, we tend to, sometimes we read this passage and we live in anxiety. Am I abiding? Am I not? Am I in the vine? Am I not? And Jesus is, he's a million miles from anxiety here. He's like, I got a house of love. It's the same sort of love Father and I share with each other. You're living in the house of love. And you're going to, as you bear fruit, I'm telling you this so that my joy will be in you. So how about that? How about my family members have a whole ton of joy inside them? And as they just live in the house of my love and my affection, they're motivated by a ton of joy. Like, none of the great things before us, none of the great difficulties before us in our culture, in our society, helping men's hearts move away from being consumers of this sort of destructive sexual content and all these different things, issues of injustice that we face, there are some very difficult things that we're facing. And as you and I go into them as believers, I hope that we go full of joy. That the joy of the Lord is our strength. And lots of times we've gone out of assignment, you know, only or duty or that sort of deal. But I actually think you're supposed to have like a full, abundant, glad life in God. And I think, you know where Paul and Silas are singing in the jail? Remember that in Acts? I used to read that only as a sacrifice of praise. Like, oh, here I am again, in jail. I've been afflicted again, bit by a snake, shipwrecked again. Here I go, you know, so always me, always happens to me. I guess this is God's lot for me. I guess we better sing some worship songs and make this, try to bring some meaning to this suffering. And that was the only kind of way I could get that. But I've come as I've understood the joy of the Lord and from the church has understood in the last 20 years or so, it's like, oh, no, joy just doesn't, it's not always connected to the circumstances. It rolls from this encounter with the Lord, this friendship with the Lord. And so we roll up with joy into unjoyful situations. We bring joy. And Jesus says, listen, I'm telling you this abiding stuff so my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. And he goes, if you obey my commands, but good thing here, he says, the Father's commandments, I've kept my Father's commandment and abide in his love. Next verse, these things I've spoken that my joy may be in you and that my joy may be full. And this is my commandment. Here you go. It went away. Go away, whatever that thing is. There's a little tiny box that's blocking me from reading. Go away. Oh, there we go. This is my commandment that you love. That never happens in my printed Bible. The verses are too tiny to read, but not little boxes appearing. Greater love has no one. Oh, he says, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. So in this passage about abiding, you have this, come live in the house of my love, in the family of my love, and you guys are going to bear much fruit. And when you bear much fruit, that gives glory to my Father in heaven. And it's not just us giving glory. I think we see other places in Scripture. It's the unbeliever who gives glory. And so the Lord is actually glorified as you and I are abiding with him. And he says, it's not just about that, doing stuff. It's full of joy. What we're about is full of joy. Abiding's full of joy. And he goes, but I have a commandment you got to keep. Oh, shucks, what is it? How about this? You love each other. Well, I guess we could do that. That doesn't seem so bad. So, you know, the commandment is that you love one another as I have loved you. And then he describes the sacrificial love and begins to prophesy about the depth of his love for his people. And so I'm going to talk to you today about bringing the kingdom. But I want to make sure that you and I, here, I'll tell you the end of the sermon, that you and I bring the kingdom while abiding, hopelessly abiding. Because as I've kind of gone through this, I'm excited about some of the things I'm learning. I'm excited about some of the things I hear preaching in our culture as far as the church's impact on culture and the church's capacity to bring the kingdom. Very excited about those things. But I do have I am concerned sometimes that we could just start going, yep, we're going to change the culture. Yep, we're engaging culture. Here we go. And we can do a lot of good works of not abiding with Jesus. A lot, you know, and do Christian things without being, you know, do kingdom things without the king. A little later if I get to it, but there's this, if we're not careful, the church has produced in the past what we call Christendom. This is kind of churchy Christian culture. It's devoid of actually relationship and presence, but it's Christendom, and almost all the time the Lord has to raise up a prophet or something that goes, I understand you got Christendom, I've got to reintroduce you to Christ. Because you have the form of it without the power of it. You bring in the kingdom, but you're not abiding. And it's lost its steam. It's lost its emphasis. So in just thinking through that very thing, I can tell you, I'll just use myself as an example as I've been listening to my environment talk about engaging the culture. And frankly, I thought that was a really crazy idea for a while. Like, I'm like, huh, we're not experts at everything. Like, man, can't we just do the church right? You know, like, so there's all this mumbling going on. So, but I began to kind of reflect on, like, my upbringing, and we'll take you way back. I wasn't alive at this time, but let's just talk through it real quick. So, you know, the Church of Jesus, it started about 2,000 years ago, and then about 1,000 years later was our first big church split, when the Orthodox Church and the Western Roman Catholic Church split from each other in 1,000 AD. So we're going along. You know, the Eastern Orthodox Church is kind of over there, and they, over time, the Muslims are chasing them up further north, and so you end up, the church ends up heading up towards Russia and that sort of deal as the expansion is happening. And you have the Western Catholic Church going along for about 500 years, but then you have Martin Luther and John Calvin and Zwingli and these guys, and about 500 years ago, they come on the scene and say, hey, the Western Catholic Church, you've lost your way, you've put tradition on the same par as Scripture, and so there was this that we protested. There was a protest movement and, you know, a revolt from that. And so so we're about 1,500 years ago. Prior to that time, the church, when I say, hey, the church is supposed to engage culture and lead in culture, for 1,500 years, actually for the first 300 years when we were getting, like, chased around and hiding, okay, there was that. But then after about like 400 or so, hey, Constantine became emperor and we're kind of in charge. Like, whoa, church is doing culture. Church is leading culture. We're no longer persecuted. We're no longer kind of hiding out. We're no longer the only illegal religion in the whole Roman Empire. So we're doing culture. And so the church was very comfortable with saying we lead culture, we influence culture. So in other words, we influence education, we influence economics, we influence philosophy, we influence art, we influence science, like very comfortable in leading in this. We all know from our history books of Galileo, though, that some of the difficulty was the church began not just to lead and impact culture, but to control culture. And again, that's where we get that interesting thing where we try to say Christendom and enforce Christendom on people who aren't Christians, who have no sense of abiding. And that's always an interesting kind of dance as we're trying to figure that out. So for 1,500 years, it's pretty normal to do this. And the mainline churches, they've run into some of this difficulty in the past. I was reading an autobiography of Soren Kierkegaard, which is a humble brag, if you will. Thankfully, it's been popularized. Stephen Backhouse, it's an award-winning book, the best autobiography from Christianity Today. But it's been really good. But he was going to talk about Kierkegaard, and this was Stephen Backhouse's phrase, is that he was introducing Christ to Christendom. Because within the Danish church, you could actually, when you got ordained to be a priest, you were kind of getting a lifetime job as a clerical governmental official. You weren't abiding necessarily. You could do it without abiding. And they actually went to the University of Civic Virtue, which was this idea that you could civic, political, you know, the kingdom, Christianity would influence society, but not really the king's abiding presence. So it's not like brand new. We're not reinventing the wheel when we talk about the church engaging culture. It's tried to for a long time. The mainline churches did this. We know that, like, Princeton, Yale, these great institutions, they were set up because they thought Christ is alive in us and let us express the king's glory in all of society and family and in religion and economics and education and governmental official, you know, and let's just everywhere. And so, but, you know, the kind of the evangelical church, or not the evangelical church, but over time, some of these mainline expressions of Christianity, the mainline universities, they kind of seem to lose their faith or lose their way a little bit. It's a little bit pulling away. So, like, the church I've been raised in was just kind of this, you know, kind of out of the Assemblies of God, kind of this charismatic Pentecostal, without tongues. We took tongues out somewhere along the line, but somewhere the same theology. Because tongues just kind of made a mess. And then also the Jesus culture, I mean, the Jesus movement sort of people, and a lot of us were kind of raised in that, you know, the late great planet Earth, and that, you know, this idea that Israel became a nation, the clock had started, and so that kind of culture a little bit was like, hey, we've seen what the mainline churches tried to do, and it's not working. So we're going to create our own culture and get away from that sort of culture. And prior to that, the fundamentalists, who started off with good intention, the fundamentalists were like, when the mainline churches that came out of the Protestant Reformation are kind of seemed to be losing their way, they're like, these are the fundamentals. These are the, I think it's 7 or 9 things. We will not, these are non-negotiables. We will not give these up. And so they were at a conference where they decided that these, we must protect these at all costs. So over time, that fundamental thing that was kind of engaging the culture kind of turned in and said, hey, we're just, we've got the truth here. You guys are lost, lost, lost. If you'd like the truth, you may come in here and get it. This is our group. We have the truth. But our need to engage society, it's just not there anymore. You guys, it's all going to burn. And 2 John says this world is passing and its desires are passing away. You know, we had scripture for it. So you kind of got that idea of being a little bit, withdrawn from culture. And you got, we're probably kind of evangelical charismatics, maybe is what we think of ourselves. But evangelicalism popped out of fundamentalism. So somewhere along the line, a couple of fundamentalists kind of went, maybe we should talk those people out there. Maybe we should say something about the cross and about Jesus. And we're like, well, if you must. So the evangelicals started going, we were evangelizing. We felt like, let's engage the culture. And so you have this evangelical movement of like, we protect these fundamentals, but we engage the culture. But in that, we have this end times, it's all going to burn. So all this is kind of colluding, at least in me, all this is colluding. Like, I had a great suspicion of culture. Like, I didn't like it. I remember as a young kid, Picasso, how could he be thought to be good? Man, he puts both eyes on this side of the head, just any sort of expression of kind of culture or art or whatever else is like, that's not for us. And we were constantly afraid of culture, as if culture was the problem. It was the problem. It was distracting us, or in trying to seduce us, or trying to entice us, and that it was completely wrong. And so that's the way we all lived. And so we created it, our own culture. So when I hear again within our circles, like, hey, we're going to engage culture, we're going to actually engage governmental, we're going to engage the political, we're going to engage the arts again. And we're gonna be making some of the great movies, the great storytellers, and we're gonna engage business and government again. I was a little bit like, on the outside, I was like, oh yeah, it sounds great. And on the inside, I had those warning lights going off, like, isn't that all gonna burn anyway? I mean, isn't that a waste of time? Aren't we arranging deck chairs on the Titanic? Like, what are we up to? So there's been this dissonance in me, a little bit, that I've just kind of been trying to figure out a little bit. And I've kind of recently kind of come in, even the way we read, so we read the Abide passage, and there's Jesus huddled with his 12, and the night he's betrayed. I mean, it's this very intimate time. And we kind of read this, it's like, almost like for me, I had boiled Christianity down to discipleship only, right? And it's just like, hey, worship, pray, lead people to Jesus. And then at the School of Supernatural Ministry that I helped lead in Reading, we had kind of made it like, we wanted to coach up the students on like, hey, do the stuff, do the signs and wonders, prophesy and speak the encouragement of the Lord and pray for a miracle, as well as appreciating the miracle of medicine as well, but pray for a miracle in that situation, pray for deliverance, all the stuff that I affectionately call the spooky church. That's kind of what we were up to there. It's like we were taking these Christians and saying, we want you to be spooky. We want you to do the stuff, like speak in tongues roll around the floor with holy delight and call us holy rollers. We're good with that. And then, having an emotional expression of the faith instead of just an intellectual one, so we were doing all that. But in about 10 years into the school, this idea began to be kind of dawning of like, hey, we're supposed to re-engage culture again. Like he was going to set the captives free as we re-engaged, not just through preaching the gospel, but yes, through preaching the gospel and discipleship, but also through, bringing the wisdom of the Lord to our culture. Remember, he says of himself in Jeremiah 9, let the wise man not boast in his wisdom, or the right, what's the next part? The mighty man in his might, or the rich man in his riches, but let him who boasts boast in this, that he understands and knows me. And so like I love that. It's one place we get to brag, like, I know God, and I have a little idea of what he's up to. And the Lord actually expresses what he wants you and I to boast about. So he says that he understands and knows me, that I exercise steadfast love and justice and righteousness on the earth. And then the best part of the verse is, and in these things I delight. So we have this God who delights in exercising steadfast love and justice and righteousness on the earth. He's delighted by them. These make God's boat float. I mean, these jazz God. Like, he's like, I love this stuff about myself. This is who I am. You know, I eat justice, love, steadfast love, and righteousness for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. The Lord is like, this is my thing. And so we, you know, this idea that we're engaging culture, bringing the justice, the wisdom, the steadfast love of the Lord, it's right in line, very powerful. Chris Valton said it really well. One of the guys that I work for, my boss, he said it, it just shocked me. You've probably heard it, but he said, like, hey, we're the light of the world, not the light of the church. And I was like, huh, you know, and I, again, because of my upbringing and the way that I read scripture, it's all meant, yeah, that means getting people saved. That means getting people saved. It's like the only way I could hear that, but the idea of actually being a light to the nations, of Jesus, you know, setting the captives free, of Jeremiah, that he's exercising justice, righteousness, everywhere, steadfast love everywhere, is like, ah, I didn't get that a ton. So partly one of the things that has helped me kind of sort through this even a little bit more was reading a book by one of my my former professors, Richard Mao, who he probably said this in class, but, you know, I didn't hear it. 25 years later, I read it in his book. I'm like, dang, you're a genius. So the, but he was talking. He took us back to Genesis chapter 1 and the mandate, God's mandate on humanity. And he was, you know, you've read it, you've heard it 100 times. Let's see if I can read it. So verse 27, chapter 1. So God created man in his own image, and in the image of God he created him, male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over all the living creatures. So there you have this mandate. And I think I always just read that. I put the two words together, be fruitful and multiply. I think I thought those were they were synonyms. They were saying the exact same thing. Basically, have a lot of kids and have a lot of kids. It's kind of how I read that. And then Dr. Mao pointed out a little bit, like, maybe he didn't point it out exactly this way, but my mind went like, what have I always thought? Like, have I always thought the Lord's original idea was that there would be a much, much bigger garden with 7 billion people? And that he'd have 7 billion gardeners walking around, and that they'd be like, hey, I'd like to name the animals, but Adam already did that, so that job's done. And, you know, they're just kind of stuck in this perpetual garden deal. And as Dr. Mao was reading him, was like, I know that he was making the case that actually the Lord, be fruitful, multiply, is actually the Lord is invested in humans and in human culture being manifested on the earth. That's weird for me because I thought human culture was the problem. It was the distraction or it was the problem. And when he was talking about, no, it's the mandate, not the problem. Creating culture is actually part of being made in the image of God. So we are culture-making machines by design. We create a set of values and attitudes and practices and beliefs, and we compare them with each other and we grow them and we can't help but create culture. And you can't even really know who you are as a human being without a culture. So when the church kind of opts out of engaging culture or only says we're going to create our own separate culture, you know, that's actually part of the problem. Well, we see this again. The Lord says, I mean, it's, you know, he says, male and female I make you, and which is, you know, in the image of God, and so you got the building blocks of identity and family right there, and then this mandates lead creation, steward it, exert your will over creation. Again, hopefully it doesn't mean like, you know, kill all the animals you can and chop down the trees you can. the wisdom of the Lord, but, you know, exert your culture on this environment, the blessing of the Lord on them. Now, it was the Lord's plan we would do that with him and for him. You know, in tandem with him, we'd abide. But I'm telling you, this fruitfulness, I think, is actually the fruitfulness of human culture in arts, government. Listen, there's always going to be a need for government. This is part of the thing, too. I always think government was a problem. Like, oh, government. I was kind of raised in church a little bit. Government. And, but government's not the problem. Just bad government's the problem. You know, righteous government's quite wonderful. there was always going to be a need to figure out what side of the road we should drive on, whether it was chariots or horses or, you know, that sort of, there was always going to need to be a need to, like, when two roads meet, what should we do? Well, let's put a stoplight. So there's always been a need for that. And furthermore, watch this, there's always been a need for politics. Dun, 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 dun. There's always been a need to build consensus, to move powerfully in order to make things, change mindsets and move people. So these things are not intrinsically evil by, like, which is the kind of the, what, I don't know if anybody taught it to me on purpose, it's just what I got. The desires of this world are, you know, going to burn, and, you know, and don't love the world or anything of the world. Later on, Jesus says in John 15, if the world hates you, it hated me first. So I'm pretty like, yeah, I hate the world back, you know, a little bit. Like, it's a little bit going on. So this idea, this mandate to create culture, and I think it's kingdom culture. This is where I'm going at this. It's like, so then he calls Abraham. He says, listen, all the nations of the world are going to be blessed through you. That's it. You know, they're all going to get saved through you. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. We'll have to see how that works out, right? even after the near sacrifice of Isaac, he adds part. He says, your enemies, like all the nations of the world will be blessed for you and you'll possess your enemy's cities. That always, I can't hear the irony in that of like, all the nations will be blessed, but we've possessed our enemy's cities? Like, that's got to be an amazing takeover if the enemies are like, I'm so glad you're in charge of our, you know, of our cities. But actually, that's not that far off. Could you imagine believers who are so abiding with Jesus that they are not moved by the lust of the flesh or the lust of the eyes or the pride of life? People who say, I am not moved by money. I'm not afraid of money. I'm not moved by it. People who know how to be servant leaders. People who can say difficult things with radical love. People who realize sometimes that some of us will live sacrificially. We create wealth and give it away. Others will create wealth and use it to steward and create more jobs. Others will say, I could create wealth, but I'm in poverty under the glory of the Lord on purpose. Not because this is the demand of all disciples, but this is my calling, my assignment. I mean, there's a breadth of ways that we can interact and begin to be transformative in culture. So the Lord takes the Hebrews out of Egypt, and what does he do? He gives them a culture. Here's how I want you to do your clothes. Here's how I want you to do worship. Here's the things I want you to eat. And then Jesus, the master teacher, the master rabbi, comes. And what does he teach? Culture. You know, bless the poor and comfort those who mourn. And that, listen, when you are a leader, and I want you to be servant leaders. That's how we're going to roll in our kingdom. And so, and he's teaching us, you know, how to do things. And then Paul comes along, and he's actually trying to take these churches and teach these folks who have nothing in common except an experience of the risen Christ and the Holy Spirit. They're both rich and poor, they're male and female, they're Jew and Greek, and they got nothing in common, but he's by the Spirit's power, he's going to knit a community together out of these strangers. And he gives them a culture. Like, hey, listen, don't eat all the food before everybody else gets there, okay? That's how we're going to do that. And by the way, if a bunch of you are freaked out about eating food to idols, then all right, we'll try not to freak you out. But the rest of us who have freedom, we're just going to eat it and not tell you. I mean, so he's kind of like, he's like... He's working through culture. You know, in Acts 15, when these good Hebrew, newly Hebrew Christians are like, they're like, hey, there's the Gentiles are getting saved. They're like, oh, yeah. All right. So do they need to get circumcised? No. What a shift right there when James, the brother of Jesus, when, you know, 2,000 years of Bible, he goes, we're not doing that anymore. It'll be a circumcision of the heart through baptism, be a sign of the covenant people, no longer circumcision. So, Papa, we are culture-creating machines. We can't help. And so this, what I want to say to you is I think the church at its best creates kingdom workers. It creates people who bring the kingdom. Now, again, some of us will be engaged actively in new things. Like, I would love for us to be the thought leaders. But we aren't the thought leaders because we quit sending our kids to college and university because we thought the rapture was coming. And so, and some of us were wondering, should we even have kids? Because, you know, the Antichrist is coming. And so, like, And, you know, and then science, don't let your kids go into science because, oh, they'll lose their faith for sure in science. And so, like, you know, we got smaller and smaller, and we should have been getting bigger and bigger and more engaged. But again, getting bigger without abiding is its own disaster, right? Getting bigger without abiding is its own sort of crazy scariness. And so it's not either or, but we tend, the enemy always wants to do that, right? Just abide in Jesus. It's just you and your little tribe, and maybe you'll make it. See who makes it. We'll see. And, you know, kind of that's what Satan says to you. And then over here, he's like, engage the culture. And then people who, like, they get trapped by money or sexuality, the pride of the eyes or the flesh or all these different things going on. It's like we need both of these things. We absolutely need both of these. And I just want to tell you, if you make furniture, like, you know, if you make furniture on your own, if you're an artisan, you don't have to be ending, you know, human trafficking. Not everybody's got to be doing all those sorts of things. Like, be cautious you don't, like, get caught up in every kind of fad if you're not, your calling's not there. But whatever you do, do to the glory of the Lord as you abide with him. And as you are, some of you just make this church life gorgeous. And I can tell you, I remember the Golas and the Cheechovs and the Sheelys and the Simpsons. I remember the families of my youth who were with my family in a time of crisis when we got saved. I don't know where they are now, but I remember the environment they made that grew up a little me. I grew up a little me. And so even some of you just like, my thing is to make Grace Center a family. Like, this is my holy service unto the Lord. We have an interesting thing at Reading where we're trying to figure out, like, you know, I grew up in, you know, we grew up like, hey, don't spend money on buildings, for crying out loud. You know, buy a warehouse. You know, that's what you should do with Jesus's money. Stick a couple more bathrooms in it, buy a warehouse, paint a Jesus on the side, and that's your church. And so, like, you know, no art, no money, no kind of culture, no, none of this. We're like, no, it's just practical. Just be practical. I don't know why I'm telling you the story. I just don't know why I'm telling you a story. I'm trying to figure out where I was. But, you know, so we get into, like, some of our brothers and sisters, the Catholic Church, the Orthodox Church, and they're like, it's art and beauty. And you go into their cathedrals, and you're like, they are saying the architects and the artisans, they do something for the glory of the Lord, and we want people to be resized when they come into this environment. So some of you are, you know, in meeting in an old school, you're like, hey, our thing, the beauty is of our relationships and of our music and of our writing, our artistry. And you create a sense of dwell here that's glorious for the kingdom. My point is, like, it doesn't have to necessarily be amazing. Like, some of you are on an adventure in bringing the king. Some of you are on an assignment. You have an assignment. It feels like you cannot get let go of this. Others of you are like saying, I just want to live in abiding with Jesus and you know, have a decent life and have decent kids. I'm like, I actually think that's one of the assignments from the Lord for some of you. In the ways that you're built, in the ways that you're molded, in the ways that you're shaped. But you are creating culture. You are creating culture. In the world's creating a counterfeit, you know, a destructive culture. It's trying to socialize us into their way. And we either got, like, we're going to make our own and socialize ourselves, or we actually going to make our own, socialize ourselves, and we're going to roll into yours without need of fame, power, money, and recognition, and we're going to help you figure out how to socialize yours under the glory of the Lord, seeing his wisdom and his justice fill the whole earth. So we talk about, you know, there's no line between the sacred and the secular. It's one of our things. There's no line between that. Everything's sacred, basically. Making furniture, making a holy, making a family, making this place. These are sacred tasks. That as you go to work, that is a sacred task. Your work is your worship. And it is not, I'd love for you to prophesy and lead your coworkers to Christ. I'd love for you to see them discipled. This is absolutely essential. But how you are bringing culture is part of your mandate as a human as well. That your work is a meaningful expression of the kingdom. If you work at the DMV, we bless you. Forgive us for all our snide remarks. You know, if you work there, we bless what you're doing and how you bring society. It's time for us, you know, to bless, you know, our politicians and to bless our government officials. Some of us need to go into politics and need to go into government, and we need to go into the sciences. We need to go into philosophy. This is, you know, we kind of stepped out as evangelicals and kind of coming out of charismatic church, and it's time for us to step back in. But abide. Get your, you know, don't step in until you've abided. Remember what he says, you'll bear much fruit. What was the mandate? Be fruitful. As you abide, you'll bear much fruit. And God says, the original mandate, be fruitful. And so I just want to encourage you as we're trying to sort it out. We're all trying to talk and write, and all the Christian super nerd, you know, Holy Spirit writers and conference people and pastors, we're all like trying to figure it out. And we're kind of groping our way to some expression of how we bring, you know, the kingdom. But this capacity that you have, the church produces kingdom workers. The church produces kingdom culture makers. And that's what you are. That's what you are. Let me pray for you and with you as I wrap up. So, Father, we receive this mandate from you. We see it again. Not just a bunch of gardeners, 7 billion gardeners, but 7 billion people bringing human culture, which was your plan from the beginning. And with your eyes closed, I just say, remember, the Lord did, he reconciled us out of sin, and he brought us back into his family, his abiding family. But the original mandate never changed. We will be bringing and practicing a culture right up until we are with the Lord. And then after that, we will still be living a culture. It's in our DNA. So Heavenly Father, we put ourselves humbly before you. Wherever we've been caught up with fleshly desires, when you've called us to greatness, you've called us to something beautiful. We've asked your forgiveness for the weak desires we've had. This weak being... C.S. Lewis said, we are satisfied with sex and drink and ambition when God's called us to so many other glorious, glorious desires. So I say, strengthen our desires. Let the holy desires arise in us. And that whether they roll from assignment, they roll from adventure, they roll from I build community, I build security in the environment, let holy desire and zealousness arise and an absolute love of your presence. In Jesus' name. Amen. I appreciate you guys. Lord bless this house.
Amen. Thank you, Dann. That was pretty awesome. Yeah, thank you so much, Dann. Well, if we could have our ministry teams come forward today. If you would like prayer, we would love to pray with you if something's been stirred here. Let me just say, I think God's really doing something. If you have not been to the Ray Hughes thing on Wednesday night, God's doing something, because these two messages actually, and by the way, the artwork up here today, Kelsey Edgecombe, spectacular. But I feel like we're sitting on a powder keg of being launched into what we're individually, personally, and corporately supposed to be about. So if you want to get some prayer about that business, we would love to do that. If you would come to this aisle over here where Rob is, has his hand raised, or if you would like to receive Jesus today, we'd love to talk to you about that as well. Have a great day, have a great week, and you are dismissed.